Well, hi there, poets. Let's get reading. Okay, so have any of you ever, watched a movie a couple times, and the first time you were just, really wrapped up in the story, but the second or third time maybe you watched a movie, you started to notice that, there were all of these, small details in the movie that really made it. The one small detail that I always notice the second time I watch a movie is, the background music, right? And how, the background music in a movie can really help me, feel what the characters are feeling and feel what the story is telling. Or, in lots of, Disney movies and stuff, there's usually little, Easter eggs and things along those lines. So those are those are small details that movie makers include, to make the movie really what it is. Poets are no different. They use small details to show feeling and impact. When you read a poem, the poet wants you to feel something and they want the poem to impact you in some way. They want the poem to change you in some way. They want the poem to teach you something in some way. And so they use small details to get that across. We're going to go over what some of those details are. I'm going to show you an example from a poem from a book I'm reading, and then you're going to read a couple poems and look for these things and how they play into poetry, right? So the very first thing, the very first small detail that poets often use is called repetition. And I love repetition. I think repetition can be used in a really fun way. And repetition sounds a lot like the word repeat, right? And so repetition means when you repeat a word or a phrase or a sound over and over again. So go, go, go. My mom makes might be a repetition, right? Because it has the M sound. Send me, send you, send us. Even though this isn't all the same thing, this could still be counted as repetition because it has send, 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 right? So repetition is when the author repeats something, a sound, a word, a phrase over and over again. The next thing that poets use, the next small detail that poets use to show feeling and impact are long words. Sometimes they'll use long words instead of short words to get something else across. So they might say enchanted instead of just interested, or they might say radiant instead of bright, right? They use longer, bigger words to get across several points. On the flip side, many times poets are fans of using short words. Lots of poets use real short, snappy words to get something across. Day, love, time, music, song, right? And they use them in real, real short ways. And that is going to show you a feeling and impact you in a certain kind of way. Another thing that poets often use, a small detail that you can look for in poetry to see how the poet is feeling or how they want to impact you in some way, is a choppy sentence. So I love her, she loves me, the ball went. Those short, choppy sentences that are maybe four words or less, those can really convey a certain kind of feeling, right? If I'm saying go to the store, get the eggs, that's much choppier and hype than, on the flip side, a flowy sentence, right? So poets also use flowy sentences. And the example I have here is, I sat and stared at the rolling green hills and wondered, right? That's much more flowy and calm and cool. And it would be much more flowy and calm and cool if I said to you, go to the store and get the eggs and the milk for me, please, young lass, right? Flowy sentences. Now, the next thing that poets use, really, this takes a good eye and a close reader. And if you don't get this one just yet, no worries. But something else they use is long vowel sounds. So a vowel is A, E, I, O, U, and sometimes Y, right? We know that in order to make a word, you need a vowel, an A, an E, an I, an O, or U. So long vowel sounds sometimes sound a certain way, or they make poems sound a certain way. So rope, quote, joke, bake, be, those long oh sounds, right? They can have a certain feeling and a certain impact. On the flip side of that, we also can have hard consonant sounds. So a consonant is everything that isn't a vowel. So B, C, D, F, G, H, J, all of those other letters that aren't A, E, I, O, U, those are a hard consonant. So a hard consonant might be get, girl, cup, cone, kite, tent, that really like harsh consonant sound. Poets sometimes use that to make you feel really, really harsh, or they can use long O sounds to make it feel more calming, right? Last but not least, poets do really fun things with punctuation. And this is a small detail that you should pay attention to while you're reading poetry. And punctuation is the stuff that comes at the end of sentences usually. So we have an exclamation point, a question mark, a period, a semicolon, a colon, and something else that poets use a whole lot that I didn't include on here is a dash. Lots of poets use dashes. Okay, so I want to show you some examples of how this is played in action. Let's go to the text that I'm reading. So right now I'm reading this book called Brown Girl Dreaming by Jacqueline Woodson. And even though it is a book, it's actually nonfiction, which means it's a true story. It's about Jacqueline Woodson's life. But instead of just writing a normal book, she wrote about her life in poetry, right? So the whole book consists of poems. Right? So I read this first poem in this book, and I thought it just did a really good job of showing how each of these comes into play and how you can find them in each and every poem if you look hard enough, right? So I did some annotating here. Okay, so first let's read the poem aloud, and then I'll take you back through some of my annotations. I am born on a Tuesday at University Hospital, Columbus, Ohio. USA, a country caught between black and white. I am born not long from the time or far from the place where my great-great-grandparents worked the deep, rich land, unfree, dawn till dusk, unpaid, drank cool water from scooped-out gourds, looked up and followed, the sky's mirrored constellation, to freedom. I am born as the South explodes, too many people, too many years. Enslaved, then emancipated, but not free. The people who look like me keep fighting and marching and getting killed so that today, February 12th, 1963, and every day from this moment on, brown children like me can grow up free, can grow up learning and voting and walking and riding wherever we want. I am born in Ohio, but the stories of South Carolina already run like rivers through my veins. So I started looking, and the first thing that I always notice in poems is repetition, because repetition is really easy to see, right? Like we know if words or phrases are being repeated. So a couple things get repeated throughout this poem. I am born gets repeated. I am born, I am born, I am born. I am born over here. And right off the bat, I know that this poem is about her birth, is about the birth of her, because she says four times that she was born. So repetition is a really easy way to like kind of figure out what the meaning of the poem is, right? Also, I have SW here for short words, right? So the I am born is short. It's also a choppy sentence, right? I am born, like boom, boom, boom. And I think that the like repetition and the choppiness and the short words of it is like really making it punchy so that you know that this is important. Like I am born, here I am, I'm about to tell you my life, right? So it's like pay attention to me because I am important. I also have a hard consonant here, a country caught. A country caught sounds rough, right? Like she's saying that the USA is a country caught between black and white. Whew, that's really powerful. And I know that that's powerful because she has that hard consonant sound, that a country caught, right? But here she switches right back to, I am born not long from the time, right? So we've really got this like ebb and flow here. It's almost like there's a black and white to this particular poem because I'm paying attention to these small details that the poet puts in place for me. Here I have some more choppy sentences, right? So where, unfree, dawn till dusk, unpaid, right? And that's really giving it that like punchy. The punchiness makes it sound bitter, but then there are also these flowy sentences like drank cool water from scooped out gourds, right? So it's almost like she hasn't really decided how she feels about where she was born or the family that she was brought into. Or anything along those lines. So the choppiness and the flowy sentences really like go back and forth with the reader I'm sorry, the choppy sentences and the flowy sentences really go back and forth with the speaker of this poem, because I don't think she knows necessarily how she feels. So she's trying to make the reader understand that she doesn't know how she feels either, right? Like, she is thankful for her ancestors, and she's thankful, you know, that people fought for her, but like, there's, it's also still a country caught, right? I think that by looking at these particular small details, I was really able to grasp the poem in a much deeper way. Okay, so let's go over your work for today. So, you need to make sure that you have completed this Ed puzzle all the way through before you start this assignment. You're going to read or listen to each poem. There is a recording of each poem on every slide. You're going to answer the multiple choice question, and then you're going to provide a reasoning or explanation for each answer. So this is an example slide, right? So here is where I kind of show you what it is that I want. I give you a question, and then you're going to just type the answer in this box, right? And then you are going to finish my sentence that I have here. So every single one will require an explanation from you, and I started the sentence, so you just have to finish it with a couple of words. So I said, I know this because it's on Miss Beaver's anchor chart, right? And like, this is just an example question. This is not going to be the answer to any of the questions that I'm asking you. If you forget what to do, there is these little videos at the top of every single page, and this is me re-explaining the directions for each and every side. So please click that, and I will read you the questions out loud so that you can hear them as well as read them, and it will remind you what to do on each slide. It's very self-explanatory, right? It's just poem, two questions, poem, two questions. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 poems for you to read. As you read and answer the questions, remember to keep this anchor chart in mind. Pull it up on the screen next to you. Keep looking back on it, right? Poets use these small details to show feeling and impact. They use these as tools so that you feel something and so that poetry impacts you in some way. Start to think about, how might repetition make me feel? How might a long, flowy sentence make me feel? How might hard consonant sounds make me feel? How might punctuation make you feel, right? Like, all of these things are going to make you feel and are going to impact you in different ways. Pay attention to that as you read this week. Looking forward to seeing you on Thursday for our writing assignment. Don't forget to fill out your reading log, and I'll see you on Google Meet. Bye.